Hello, everyone. My name is Louis. My colleague here is Moritz. I guess we sell shoes for a living, kind of. Actually, no, we are both engineers at Zalando, and both of us worked together with other colleagues on this project called Mosaic, which is the topic of this talk today. And to start off, I guess we have to give you a little bit of context about Zalando so that you understand some of the challenges that we faced and why we had to build Project Mosaic. That's why you have a buddy to help you go back. So for those that don't know who Zalando is, this is probably the easiest way to figure out what we do. We have this web shop, the fashion store, and we sell fashion to around 15 countries in Europe, still limited to Europe. We have around about 19 million customers active. The numbers are pretty interesting, but I don't remember all of them, and you probably wouldn't care anyway. This is also another thing that is interesting.
What are you doing?
It's broken.
Let me be your clicker.
Okay, please. Thank you. So apart from that fashion store website that I already showed, we also do some mobile apps because everyone is doing them. Not only that, we actually get a huge chunk of our traffic already on mobile. So we try to cover all of these platforms, the common ones, but we also do some cool, interesting stuff, not only this, because we are a tech company, and sometimes we do some interesting stuff, like sending shoes to space. This is no Photoshop. This is actually a capture of our camera on the spaceship when we send it to the stratosphere. We actually recovered both the shoe and the camera, and this is why we have the full footage. If you follow that blog post link, you will find the full video, or rather the edited video, that it shows the launch, reaching the stratosphere, and the recovery of the spaceship.
And we did this for the most important reason, just because we can.
Yes. So as a tech company, these are some of those numbers that I was starting to mention. One that is more important for this particular talk is the dimension of how many people, how many teams we have working with us. We have these 7 tech hubs across, well, Germany, but also in Helsinki and in Dublin. And the current numbers point to something like around 1,600 engineers, which is a shitload of teams already. So many that some time ago, things were not really working so interesting anymore. This brought some challenges that my colleague now is going to explain.
Yeah. I mean, as you can probably imagine, a company at the size of Zalando and at the growth rate of Zalando also has a huge amount of code. Our company grew fast and our code grew fast with it. And I'm probably not telling you something new when I'm telling you huge code bases have huge challenges, especially huge legacy code bases. Huge legacy code bases have an effect on productivity. There are always dependencies in huge code bases. There are technical dependencies, there are non-technical dependencies, there are dependencies inside the code, there are dependencies to third-party libraries. So every change to a huge legacy code base requires a huge amount of coordination. And that coordination, most of the time, is over multiple departments, spanning many people. And we learned today in the keynote, coordination doesn't really scale. So in the end, we reached a point where the law of diminishing returns were kind of hitting us a little bit. So the more effort, the more resources we put into the code, we weren't really getting a linear amount of more result. It was slowing down. So there is a drag if you have a huge code base. But that's not the only effect that huge code bases have. They also have effects on innovation. We all know the stories of small, nimble companies running circles around the big, huge ones. And that's just because changes, radical changes in huge code bases are super difficult. For one thing, they have lots of bugs. There are studies that show that the ratio of bugs to lines of code is more or less constant. So the more lines of code you have, the more bugs you have. And that's not even the bad part. Codes can be fixed, but usually in those huge code bases, other parts of the code rely on those bugs to be kind of a feature. So I guess you all notice you change something down here, and up there, something seemingly unrelated suddenly breaks, and you're wondering, why? So weird side effects all over the place. And usually the way to handle this and not break in production is rigid processes. You have strict code reviews, you have long Q&A times, you can't release that often. And this just makes innovation really, really hard. And maybe not finally, but there is also an effect on growth. So huge tech stacks, huge tech bases, code bases, they have to be learned. Onboarding is slow. And usually legacy applications are built around, let's say, a well-established tech stack. And most good developers don't really like well-established tech stacks. They are boring. They want to work with the cool new stuff. They want to learn new stuff. So the end result is huge code bases are less magnetic. That makes hiring slower. That makes growing slower. Also, maybe after this keynote, most of you have heard of Conway's Law. I heard it a few times in talks on this conference. So Conway's Law, simple put, states organizations which design systems are constrained to produce designs which are copies of the communication structures in those organizations. So if you have lots of communication inside your company, your code will probably kind of look the same. So a while ago, we tried to use that to our advantage. We tried to hack our organization to improve our systems. About 1.5, 2 years ago,
yes,
one and a half years ago, we tried something radical. Zalando announced radical agility. And I wasn't at Zalando at the time, so Louis will explain it to you.
I was happy to be part of that. So we just mentioned these issues with innovation, with growth, everything that was troubling our company, and obviously we had and we still do. We have this growth perspectives for the business and for the organization, and we kind of identified that this was the problem. So we had to do this radical change that we called radical agility, and the gist of it is that we contradict this thing, and we change the way the organization works to make sure that instead of just let's do microservices because everyone is talking about them at conferences, okay, that's easy, right? What is not is actually changing the entire culture of a company which was already big enough at the time, around 800 software engineers, or at least in tech, and we had to make these big changes. The most important one, and it was already announced in a talk exactly in this room yesterday, was about the autonomous teams. Actually, radical agility is based on a couple of principles, but this is the most important one for this particular project, for Project Mosaic, which was autonomy to the teams, because only this autonomy could give them the power to innovate at the speed that they needed, and plus easier onboardings. But we will see at the end of this talk how this project ended up delivering that. So we wanted that radical agility based on the principle of trust instead of control, sits on top of purpose, autonomy, and mastery. I won't bother you again with the explanation of all of them, but these are the main pillars of radical agility. You can then afterwards check the slides, because I honestly love this particular slide, so you can get the slides afterwards. The idea is that we have, yes, that's it. So now we try to combine the principles of microservices and radical agility, right? So we basically now have a purpose-driven organization composed of autonomous teams which deliver clearly defined products. And if you remember, the promise of microservices was a service-oriented architecture composed of loosely coupled elements that have bounded context, right? So job done. Now we have an organization that matches microservices. Here we go. Everything is done, is it?
Yeah. We have that now. It's done. It's cool. We all develop heavily ever after. Or not. I mean, with all those cool microservices, everything loosely coupled, there is a small thing that a lot of people don't really talk about. There's a small taboo, and that's what we call the front-end taboo. Does the front-end developers really benefit of any of those promises? Here are three common promises. You could discuss later if those are really the promises of microservices, but something along those lines is always mentioned. So you have teams that work autonomously, you have a mix of different tech stacks, you have completely independent release cycles. All of this is great, but let's have a look at this from the front-end perspective. So front-end need data, need APIs. So in the back-end, you have two teams, they all maintain their APIs, some written in Scala, some written in Clojure, some written in, I don't know, let's say Elixir. Everyone is happy, everyone is doing whatever they want. But the best APIs, at least to the end customer, to our customer, buying shoes from us, are completely meaningless if there is not a cool front end with great user experience in front of it. And someone has to build also this front end. And unless you want your front end to look like a complete patchwork built by 100 different teams,
AWS console,
ideally it is, yeah. You need some kind of common principles there. And most companies solve that by having a front-end monolith where multiple teams contribute to. And even if you have a few of them for different areas of your business, you still have a code base where multiple teams contribute to. And this is not really the promise of microservices. Can those teams work autonomously? No, they have to coordinate. Otherwise, they get merge conflicts in the front end. They are not really autonomous. And can they mix different technology stacks? Well, no. I mean, assume you have one team that prefers, let's say, vanilla CSS over using less because, why would you want that? Because they like to type more, I don't know. Or you have another team that prefers TypeScript over JavaScript because they like types more, I don't know. Good luck introducing that to a front-end monolith. The teams just won't agree to different stacks in one application, usually, especially if there are multiple teams, dozens of teams. So, no different tech stacks and independent release cycles? Well, that's also not going to happen. I think at Zalando we had a few occasions where we couldn't release a feature, even though it was done, because the front-end monolith itself was in a broken state because some other feature just wasn't ready for release. So, front-enders are kind of left in the rain. They don't get any of the benefits of microservices. And about a year, year and a half ago, we also realized that, and we took a step back and we asked ourselves, can we do better? Can we build something that somehow has some of the benefits of microservices even for the front-enders? And
let's watch. We
might not came up with a perfect solution, but we came up with a solution that works for Zalando, and that was so well-regarded that someone decided to make a small film about it.
Shop was just starting to become an issue. It started to show.
It was hard to add features or to fix bugs without breaking something miles away in a different code path.
Well, how can we do this? How can we break apart this and build something else? Everyone was suffering. Something needs to change. Something needs to be done. If only we knew, right, that everything was about to change. Imagine that for the next 15 months, you are not delivering product features. You are working on rebuilding this completely from scratch. Wow. Wow. Wild idea.
They told me that they want to get rid of the legacy application and rebuild it in a scaling way with microservices. And it sounded crazy and weird.
Usually a company chooses a technology and then they stick to it.
The thing is called Mosaic. Cut the page into different fragments, and all the different fragments are streamed to the browser in the order that the fragment delivers the content. And in the browser, it is assembled in the right order using JavaScript.
So this is a big part of autonomy we give to the team.
To deliver your services the way you want them.
Using the coding language that you prefer, and I think this is what they value a lot.
Someone decided to go all in and amp up the risk a little bit, and
the decision
was made that the first thing to move to the Mosaic architecture was supposed to be the checkout.
The biggest concern, obviously, is that this is effectively where the money stream comes from. So one thing we knew, we cannot afford to have any downtime. We cannot stop this, even if it's just for a couple of minutes, plus the risk would be unmanageable.
Giving the power to change is very important. Giving the autonomy to such a group of people, change the status quo, and to do something really relevant requires you to enable them to go wild. You may be very well surprised. this is the best opportunity to do it. You could deliver something that will go in the history of Zalando.
So we were actually part of the lucky ones that work on this project. Actually, some of them are sitting here. Thanks for being here.
Okay. So our solution is named Mosaic because in the end, our pages are assembled from different unique pieces, but they form a beautiful whole, at least we hope. It's also kind of a reference to the NCSA Mosaic browser, which used to be the first popular browser. It pushed the web a lot forward, and we hope to push it even a tiny bit further. If you want to learn more about it, we have a website, the landing page, mosaic9.org. The 9 is not a typo, it's really there. It is another reference. Does anyone know Plan 9? Doesn't matter.
If you want to know more after this talk, because we will explain what it
Someone knows Plan 9 from outer space. I like that. It's supposed to be the worst movie of all times. So, Mosaic, basically you can think about it as an architecture description that introduces three core concepts. The first core concept is a fragment. It's easiest to think about a fragment as a plain old microservice that returns partial HTML markup. Partial in the sense that it usually omits the HTML head and body parts. Fragments are owned by teams, kind of like microservices are owned by teams. There is no clear one-to-one relationship, but usually a team should own a very small number of fragments, take care about a small number of fragments. In our case, a fragment on a page could be something like the header, the navigation, the shopping cart, the search results, the review section. All those are good examples of fragment. Fragments themselves, they don't nest and they don't really talk to each other. Fragments get all their data and all their business logic from underlying APIs, from classic microservices. So fragments should be pretty much dumb. Their only concern is rendering. They should not contain business logic, only rendering logic. And in modern web frontends, that is usually enough of a concern for a microservice. Otherwise, you end up with tiny monoliths that do way too much. So fragments are nice, but we need something to assemble them. And that thing that assembles a whole page out of fragments is the second core concept that Mosaic introduces. That is what we call the layout service. The layout service is controlled by a template per page, and that template decides which fragments take part in the composition of a page. Templates are also owned by a team, but not necessarily by the team that own the fragments. So there could be teams that only take care about templates, and they assemble their pages from fragments of different teams. And the final part, we kind of need something else here. To make it a real mosaic, the third part that we need here is the router. The router makes sure or determines which requests go where. It handles AJAX requests. AJAX requests normally don't return HTML, but JSON, so they don't hit a fragment, they hit microservices directly. So we need a router in front of it. Every client request first hits the router looks at it, oh, this is a page request, goes to the layout service, chooses a template, or, oh, this is an AJAX request, and directly goes to some backend. Think of it kind of like a reverse proxy. The router and the layout service are applications that we created, and if you joined the talk from Felix yesterday, you will not be surprised that they are open source. Our router is named Skipper, and our layout service is named Taylor. Fragments, there isn't really anything to open source. Could be something like Spring Boot, I don't know. It's really just a microservice that returns partial markup. The configuration, which routes for the router to decide which request goes where, we started with some simple file-based configuration, but we realized we need an API to control that. And that API is called Innkeeper. You guessed it, also an open source application. Same thing for the templates. They started as a file system-based thing, as the whole system grew. We realized we need an API with access control, with revisioning, and so on. That is called Kilt, and let me repeat, open source application.
Let's talk about these components,
yeah,
right?
Let's talk about the three things in a little bit more detail.
Right. So let me get this one. So I'd like to talk now about the routing part. Let's start from the top. Customers request hit this edge service called Skipper. And as we said, it's relatively simple in nature. It's just a transparency reverse proxy. What it does is that it receives a request, makes a decision based on how should we serve this request, and we have obviously this called routing table. So in a way, it decides where to send it, and then the response comes back and returns it back to the customer. And it would sound like it's a simplistic thing, why we need it. Well, we actually always need something else. And some of the things that we do, for example, apart from designing how to serve this request, are overarching security measures, for example. For once, if we need any DDoS protection and whatnot, we know that we only need to protect this one. We don't need to protect everyone because this is the one hiding everyone behind. So we only need to protect Skipper for this reason. Other security measures, for example, are in the whole hierarchy of microservices, only Skipper needs to know the secret keys that we use and rotate to encrypt customers that are the cookies that we send to the customer's browser. Only this particular component needs to know anything about this. We also implemented nifty stuff like cross-site request forgery protection as part of Skipper so that no one else needs to do it by themselves. All of these things end up being handled there. And then, obviously, because it's part of Mosaic, and as you will learn in more detail further ahead, one of the things that Mosaic introduced was better performance by means of something that is actually not rocket science, but that had to be agreed upon with all of components. For example, the chunk flushing and early streaming of results as soon as we start receiving them from our components internally. So then we are also introduced some nice features like runtime updating of routes. So we don't need to redeploy, we don't need to restart anything. We can push new routes at runtime and the component just accepts them immediately and we can switch immediately to something else or, for example, address a fuck-up like we had. And in case you are curious, this is an open source component written in Go, the language. We actually explore many others. We went with this one due to reasons. One thing that we had kind of a requirement that it serves perfectly our purpose, as you will understand, is that we could not afford, as I mentioned in the video, we could not afford to have any downtime. So you need to switch from whatever you had before, which by the way is our monolith, Jimmy, we call it Jimmy. So we had to switch from our monolith, Jimmy, into this brave new world without any downtime. So one of the nifty things that Skipper allows us to do is that you can hijack a URL, only a specific URL, let's say uninteresting, completely uninteresting page, and you can hijack that one, and instead of hitting the monolith, then you already forward this to the new world of Mosaic. You send it to Taylor, the layout service, which then hits some fragments and returns a brand new page, which may or may not look exactly like the old one, but obviously we try to aim at making things look similar. This is great, because then we no longer have a Big Bang rollout. We can easily switch parts of traffic from the old monolith to this new architecture, measure things, see if everything is fine, and then with confidence switch more traffic or switch more URLs. And we can hijack a couple of them, hundreds, or at one point switch everything that is already available in the new world. This is also good for the autonomy because we have all of these different teams delivering at different points in time. So whenever they are ready, they can hijack their own URLs and start serving their own stuff, which is great. Yeah, so details now about this. Along with Skipper, we also introduced this DSL to define routes. It's, again, not very complex. It actually consists of very simple things, a route ID, a couple of predicates. We can have multiple predicates to match the requests, a couple of filters. I will explain exactly what they are, and one endpoint. This is what it does. So keep in mind that to have a route, you give it a route ID, you have some predicates to match the request to decide which one it fits, and then it will have to go through a list of filters to finally make it to the endpoint. Next. Let's focus first on predicates. These are two examples. Pretty simple. Anything that you know exists in an HTTP request, you can use to match. You can see if there is an exact path matching. You can use a regular expression to see if this path matches with a regular expression. You can use test for the presence of a given header with a given value, or some specialized cases like cookies, the presence of some cookies. So you can use a lot of these things. The documentation is always up to date, because every time that we publish this open source, for those that know, the Go docs immediately refresh this, so the documentation is always updated also. And I believe nowadays there are plenty more predicates than this. We keep introducing new ones, like, for example, weighted traffic. You have two routes, for example, for A-B testing, and you give different weights to those different two things. For example, to introduce a new feature in the new world, but only a percentage of it. So you can always create your own predicates. Very simple. It's just a Boolean function that returns true or false if you receive this HTTP request. If it matches whatever the logic inside your predicate, you return true, and then it matches. And it's very easy to extend. And we've been doing it ourselves, including for internal purposes, for secret stuff that we have in our labs. So next one, if you remember, we had predicates. OK, this route matches. And now we have a chain of filters. Filters is also quite interesting, because this allows you to change anything in the inbound requests, or in the reverse order, as soon as your downstream produced the response, you can also manipulate your response before it's sent back to the customer browser. We do all kinds of crazy stuff in here, particularly to support and to handle the smart things that we did in Jimmy. So this has actually been our Swiss Army knife most of the times when we find those weird things that we did in the past, someone did in the past. We end up creating some interesting filters to handle those things. Today, and plenty of teams are adopted them. It's no longer just being used for the fashion show, for the website that we've shown. Today, we have multiple Zalando teams using either Mosaic as a whole or components that we built. Skipper, namely, is being used as API gateway to switch between mobile traffic to desktop traffic, for example. We had a very interesting use case that we want to protect an Elasticsearch cluster with OAuth authentication in front. So what we did, we deployed Skipper in front of it, and it just works. I already mentioned the weight traffic control, where we can have two very similar routes to do the same URL, but then we have this weight, and we say 10% use version A, the rest use version B. It's also very interesting. And you can also use it to serve static files, guess what? and there are some other features, for example, the compression proxy to gzip your content in case your other systems don't do it. As I said, you can create custom predicates if the ones that are already in the open source version are not good enough. You can create them easily, predicates, filters. The principle is that you can be creative and do whatever you want to run this.
Maybe one more thing. It is running for us rock solid. Every Zalando page is behind Skipper right now, and at peak times it serves 8,000 requests per second. Over multiple instances, but it scales horizontally perfectly.
True.
Okay, so before we talk about the layout service, I quickly want to talk about fragments and kind of the communication protocol that exists between fragments and the layout service. But really, there is not a lot to talk about. As I said, fragments are plain old microservices. They return partial HTML markup. They don't have their own head. They don't have their own body. That comes from the layout service. And everything else is based on HTTP headers. There is no special magic protocol. Everything is HTML and HTTP headers. Skipper itself adds, via filters, quite a few HTTP headers to the request that are then just forwarded through the system. Things like user IDs after users has been authenticated, the original request URL, the language that the response is supposed to be in. And the fragments can get all of those information from HTTP headers. Standard headers where applicable, so for example, language is a standard header, and custom Zalando filters, X Zalando customer number, or something like that. It's not exactly like that for places where necessary. We use standard headers also for some kind of optimization purposes. So in the response of a fragment, fragments are encouraged to early flush their response headers. This allows the Mosaic architecture to do some optimizations. So a fragment might, for example, announce which JavaScript and CSS files it needs in its headers. It can early flush that. The layout service can get that information and make the browser already prefetch those files, even though the actual fragment response might still be 20 database calls and 200 milliseconds away. The browser could already start fetching stuff at that point. Yeah, this is basically it for fragments. Use whatever technology you want. It's HTTP in, it's HTML out. Again, with some custom headers, but nothing magic there going on. The real magic happens at the composition side in the layout service. As we mentioned, our layout service is called Taylor. And Taylor is the thing that collects all the fragment responses. It also triggers all the fragment responses in parallel. And it streams the responses to the client. The whole thing is loosely based on an approach by Facebook called Big Pipe. The Big Pipe approach streams parts of the page part of the response to the browser in the order that the services in the backend respond. But this naive approach wasn't really working for what we have in mind. For Facebook, a Facebook page always returns 200. There is no 404 on Facebook. But in our case, we might want 404s for SEO reasons, or we want redirects. So for example, if you go to an article that is out of stock, we might want to redirect you to the brand of that page. Article. Yeah. So in this system, who should be in charge of that redirect? So we came up with a system where some fragments are special. So you could have a primary fragment, and that primary fragment, we wait for that response to get an actual status code, things like that. The layout service, as we have it, is written in Node.js, but this is really just an implementation detail. The only thing it really shows is that we have and we had some pure JavaScript wizards in our team that were able to hack that thing together in JavaScript, but it's running rock solid for us. Okay, so I think I just said everything I wanted to say here on the previous slide. The actual composition, which fragment are part of a page, this is all defined in a template. And that template is more or less an extension of HTML. So a template might look something like this for the previous page. So we have some pure HTML in there, and then you have custom tags that actually trigger the requests to fragments. So here in the head, you have the header fragment, and the attributes configure how, the URL of those things. There are some more attributes, but the main thing that you need to set is the source, and this tells the system where the fragment responds to. As I mentioned earlier, with the primary fragment, you can mark one fragment as primary, and this has the effect that nothing will be sent to the browser until we have the status code of the primary fragment. The status code of the primary fragment will be the status code that is sent to the browser.
It's not mandatory.
Yeah, and if you have more than one, there is an error at the time where you load the fragment, not where you insert the template, not at the time where you load the page. I mentioned Facebook's Big Pipe approach earlier. Ours is kind of different and more flexible. We also have the ability to have this Big Pipe thing where fragments stream to the browser in the order that the responses come in. But by default, also for SEO reasons and so on, they are streamed to the browser serially in the order that they appear up there. But if you have a fragment that is fine to come whenever, you can tag it as async, and then it just the streaming to the browser skips over that thing, and whenever you get a response from that fragment server, that thing is streamed to the client and then put in the right position on the page with JavaScript. I mentioned a few more options. For example, there is error handling. Here, the header has a timeout defined of 500 milliseconds. If the header fails to respond within 500 milliseconds, we have a fallback thing. And due to the simplicity of fragments, it happens that a static HTML file in an S3 bucket is actually a completely valid and fine fragment, and a fragment that has a really, really good uptime. So for some things like the header, we just have static fallbacks that don't do any magic. They're just a header. They live in an S3 bucket, and when something fails, hit from the S3 bucket, everything's fine, at least to the customer. We might lose some features, but the page is still completely usable. Okay.
Before we go to a very interesting demo, because we will live demo this.
So the result.
God help us. let's go back, because we just explained everything that we did and what we achieved. And if you remember correctly, we had the issues and we had the radical agility changes, and because we were suffering from those things. And now I would like to go back a little bit to, going forward, actually, sorry, not go back. I will go back to those issues, but first, so this is it. This is what it stands for today, okay? This is, for example, the website being rendered on a mobile device interestingly looking good, I guess. And this is all composed by Mosaic, okay? We keep releasing new things to Mosaic every day. Nowadays, I think we are completely live with a lot of features like the wish list, the product detail page, a couple of things, and all of this progressive rendering is happening today. So this is pretty much what we achieved technically, but I would also like to mention what we achieved in terms of the organization, in terms of the pains that we were feeling. So I think we tackled all of those three major components that were hurting us. In terms of the innovation, now, as you understood, teams can push routes at runtime. They can deploy their own fragments whenever they want. They can have as many releases as they want on a daily basis, assuming they will do a good job and that there is no downtime, obviously. But this is what we expect. So now no one is blocked to release their own features by anyone. They can just do it whenever they want. The network is just putting everything together. So in terms of innovation, we believe that we achieved this because HTTP is quite standard. Markup is quite standard. They are free to write this however they want. They can use Node.js, they can use Java, they can use whatever they want. In terms of productivity, obviously for all of the same reasons, now we have these teams that finally feel like they own their product. They are no longer just injecting pieces of code, random pieces of code to a huge monolith that then no one owns. And particularly when it's busted, who gets to solve it? No, today they actually feel like they own the whole thing, and they feel this responsibility to maintain it. And everyone has their own continuous delivery, pushing code on green and having lots of fun with features going live really fast. Obviously, because now we are not enforcing these things, and by the way, internally we use these Postgres and Java and JSPs and jQuery or whatever, now it's very easy to onboard because no one is telling them, you're going to join their team to do this. No, no, bring your creativity, bring your toolkit, do something interesting, deliver innovation. So we believe that we actually maximize all of these three major issues that everyone cares about. And this was the delivery from Mosaic. And I hope you agree. But we also want to show you an interesting demo because I believe time still allows it.
Yeah. OK. So how do you demo an architecture? I think we came up with a nice way. Here, you see our product page, served by Mosaic, about 8 fragments. That's it. No, of course not. What I would like to show you is having a small legacy application and try to take it over with Mosaic. So,
are you sure you want to do that?
I'm sure I want to do that.
Is it
safe? As you all know, when working with legacy code, there is one important rule. Always wear your safety goggles. You'll never know what happens. So, with the safety goggles in place, I think it's reasonable to start a legacy application. Of course, I can't start the currently running version because that would take hours to start up, so I'm starting an older version. So...
Ah, the sound is not really...
I hope we get a mainframe link. Oh, yeah,
oh,
good.
Nice.
We have a mainframe link. Okay, it's running. Fine. Okay. So, what you see here? It's the oldest version of the legacy application. At that point, Zalando was still a rubber duck store. You can clearly see that it's legacy because it is from the time where Comic Sans was an acceptable font for a web shop. But it has everything you need. It doesn't have my mouse cursor, though. Oh, here it is. It has a header. It has some navigation.
And a very slow feature.
Catalog. It has the slow feature that slows the whole thing down. No one really knows what that feature does. Some product manager insisted it is there. It makes everything slow. But it has to be on every page. It has a product detail page, like every normal shop. OK, so we want to take that over. So the first thing we do is we bring a skipper instance in place.
And put it in front.
In front of it. So for that, we need a route, like Lewis explained to you. We have a catch-all route, meaning every request goes to that thing. I also have a filter in place that sets a header so that we can see it's actually working. So, is the font size okay? Can everyone read that?
Back there. Okay. Is it readable? Cool.
So, I hope it... In the demo, I will use the... You're right. In the demo, I will use the file-based stuff just because it's simpler. There is one downside. The file-based stuff does not support runtime updates, so you will see me restarting Skipper from time to time. In a real production setting, you would not restart it.
Pull requests.
Yeah, we would accept. We accept pull requests. Skipper has outside contributors. It's a good project to work on. Okay, so as you can see here,
1990.
One route was accepted, and that thing goes to 1990, port 1990. By default, or in a real setting, you would now point your DNS to Skipper, but since this is all running on my machine, I use port magic to wiggle between them. So instead of port 3000, we use 1990.
No.
I cannot see what I'm typing there.
Okay. Yes, 1990, and you can go to the dock.
Whoop.
It's good.
Okay, it's just slow. So, still the same slow shop. Still everything works. No, don't break it. Okay. Everything slow, but still works. That legacy shop is so slow. Okay, and if I click here, what you probably can or cannot see, there's World Jimmy, the header that I set. Pretty much here where this
visible,
thing is.
No.
Okay.
It says Jimmy, believe.
So now we identify some fragments. What we want is a header fragment, we want a product fragment, and we put that slow feature into its own fragment, just for good measure. So for that thing, we need a template. Let's see. Whoop. And cool.
It's the duck.
Readable. So more or less the same page. It has a header fragment. It has a slow feature fragment, and it has a product details fragment. Again, they would live under their own DNS names, but for demo purposes, ports.
Ports.
You can see that the header is listening on port 5000, the slow feature is listening on port 6006, and the product details is listening on port 7000. You might be wondering why it's not listening on port 6000. If you only learn one thing during that thing, it's that Chrome has something that it considers unsafe ports, and absolutely denies connecting to those ports. I learned that while creating this demo. Reason being that those ports are usually belong to some other protocols, and they don't want Chrome to be used in DDoS attacks against those protocols, so it's unsafe for the servers listening there. It is a short list, but it is there. Those ports Chrome will never connect to. And 6000 apparently belongs to X11. I wasn't aware of that. Okay, so I have the fragments already running. I can show you. Ooh, that was not what I wanted.
Ooh, TV wants to turn off.
So this is a sample curl request to a fragment, and whoop. You can see here is some HTML without head body returning, and there is a link header saying this file would like to have a CSS file up there. Okay, so let me start the layout service. As I said, it is an Node.js application. So what we do with this, in contrast to Skipper, it is rather quiet. It only says something when shit goes wrong. As long as it's running, it's just happily sitting there. Okay, now we need to add a route so that we can actually take that thing over. We could already test it like that by hitting the layout service directly, but
let's hijack the duck.
Yeah, let's hijack the duck. This is not helping down there. The TV is now showing me such a big box telling it will automatically turn off in
1 second, it's gone.
Ooh, that makes it more difficult. Okay, let me just quickly
I can
type
guide
it
you.
Here.
Left,
I'll bring
left,
it back to
right,
you in
right,
a second.
Right. it's back.
It's back. Okay, cool. So duck needs a path predicate for the path duck. And I also set a response header just to show you it's working.
Duckies.
This, no, mosaic.
Mosaic.
And it needs a backend, which in our case is localhost 8080 is where the layout service by default listens to. And the template selection happens over the path. So my template is named duck.html, which you cannot read in the bottom of Emacs, but it's just duck and a semicolon. Okay, looking good. Okay, so if I now restart Skipper, you see that it has
catch all
two
legacy
routes,
and the
catch
duck.
All and the duck route. And if we now reload the page, it is surprisingly faster. Except the slow feature is still breaking everything down, and you can also see it's loading other CSS, so it's
it
now
looks
using
better, though.
Futura, a font from the future.
Fancy.
The home is still slow and in Comic Sans. Also, yeah. As I mentioned, we support this big pipe style approach where we can stream the fragments in the order that the servers respond. So let's try that out. For that, the only thing we need to do is make this thing async.
This
actually supports hot reloading, so now we see duck is already there and the slow feature comes
only
in
now,
at some point. This is, I think, now what's called progressive rendering. I don't know. Okay, and one final feature I want to show you. After this thing is live, everything is happy, and now some team goes to the slow feature team and tells them, you know, there's if you have slow services, there is this cool trick called Ajax that you can use. Maybe you can leverage that somehow to not slow down the whole page. And they go to work, and they work, and they work. And then they release a new version of their fragment. And they go to the template, which is in an API, and they're allowed to edit it. And what they do is they point it to their new version of the fragment, which is, oh, is it called? I think it's called Ajax, I hope. And for their Ajax request to work, they, of course, also need a route in Skipper so that Ajax requests for specific routes directly go to their fragment. So for that, it is slow Ajax. Path is everything under API slow. This is kind of the convention that we have internally. So it's slash API slash team name so that you cannot overrun other teams' routes. The API that we mentioned, Innkeeper, actually validates so that you don't accidentally break other people's routes, but conventions also help make it more easy. Oh, I said a response header and never showed it. I can quickly show you that also. Duck. And here you can see the world is mosaic. Okay, this, I'm not setting a response header, I'm just saying everything on this request goes to localhost on what is the slow feature? 7000, right?
Probably.
Yeah, 7000. No, 6000.
6000. And
good
six.
That someone checks. Okay. Again, I need to restart Skipper, sadly, for this demo. It now has three routes. And now if we reload this page, you can see it has a loading. And after the slow feature loaded, slow feature.
Cool.
Think so, too. That's it for the demo.
But in a nutshell, this is exactly the kind of things that you could very easily do under your own reality and your own migration path or whatnot. And these are the kinds of things that you're going to get out of the box for free. Obviously, as we mentioned, that we have some interesting stuff that we had to implement either as filters or something else to address Zalando specifics. They are not even secrets because they would be no value outside. So. But we did mention that it's very easy to extend either Skipper or even Taylor, because they are both libraries, actually. Then you wrap them in your own binary the way that you prefer.
So, questions?
I guess we still have time, because there was no announcement, right? Thank you. Thank you. We should probably get some... this one, I guess?
Can you?
Do you mind?
Yeah. So I just need a second to log back in, but does anyone have a burning question they want to ask?
I think there were two or three in the room.
Yes, yeah. There are a couple of hands.
I think you were.
Can you pick someone first? Or you want me to? All right.
Just ask, I'll repeat.
Okay. So maybe the question that everyone is asking is any implementation or use of that technology outside of Zalando? I mean, like, any other companies are using it already now, or you just to convince all of us to use
not,
it?
Not that we are aware of. We had people very interested in it, but because it's open source, we don't require anyone to let us know. So this has been out there for a year on GitHub, and we already been in at least two conferences giving this talk, explaining what it is about. Some people were more interested, some people were only in parts. What we believe from even internal adoption that we never forced anyone to, and all of those use cases came up naturally. We expect people outside to be using it, but as I said, we never required anyone to give us feedback, hey, we are using it for this or this reason. So I wouldn't be able to tell you how many in which use cases.
Also, this is a solution that we came up with in our requirements and for our scale. Especially for smaller components, this is probably ridiculous overkill. If you have 10, 20, 30 front-end developers, a front-end monolith might be a better choice. But I know that Skipper has outside contributors, so maybe there are other people at least evaluating it. We have a subsidiary that is using it, so at Zalando there are at least two deployments of this architecture. Yep.
So, if you have a lot of legacy URLs, how long can this path list be when you have kind of no system in your old URL structure and you want to keep the old URL structure for some reason?
So, first of all, those things support regular expressions and wildcards. That makes it easier to take over a whole bunch of routes. In our case, for example, all product pages, product detail pages, they end in star HTML. So everything that is star HTML goes to the new service that to the new thing for the product detail page. And apart from that, we have
static URLs, particularly for campaigns and things like that, where the actual content of the URL, depending on the country where it is, has value in it. And even after the campaign is gone, we want to preserve it for quite some time. So this adds up. And we may end up having thousands of routes. But by the way, this was concern number one, building Skipper, and the reason why we couldn't adopt anything out there, the speed of the routing, making decision. So one of our colleagues spent pretty much the whole time working specifically on the radix tree that we use to find the matching routes, which is quite awesome. And this was the first concern exactly to address that, a stupidly immense amount of routes.
Just that path matching is its own Go open source library that we pulled out, and we benchmarked it with multiple hundred thousands of routes, and it is still...
Yes, and the benchmarks are public in the GitHub repo. We benchmarked that.
It gets drastically slower the more regular expressions you have in there, of course, but it is fast enough for our use cases.
Check the results. They are public.
Thank you.
Sure.
Thanks. This is all very interesting. I'm wondering, there is some overlap with existing stuff. For example, the fragmentator reminds me of ESI or SSI, which that includes, service that includes, and the front-end part, Skipper, reminds me of basically a proxy like Nginx or whatever server.
Yeah.
So what are some of your thoughts? Why did you actually invest the time to do this? What were the main reasons of not basing it on something existing?
Skipper, for example, we actually evaluated Nginx, but we needed more flexibility, and at that time, Lua scripting in Nginx wasn't ready when we started. We evaluated another product that was written in Go that Skipper then is heavily based upon.
Vulkan D,
but that did not support streaming. And for our thing, our smart pipe approach, we specifically needed streaming. So there was a lot of research into prior art. The layout thing, at some point, to me, it felt like we are reinventing portlets. just by adding more network layers in some positions. But I think this adding more network layers actually is what makes it more flexible. You don't have this application server. You have different parts of the system that you could iterate up on independently. And I think we are in contact with, which other company was it that does something similar?
A couple of them.
There is some knowledge exchange with other companies.
Yeah.
Great. We have time for one more question.
Okay.
Hi. So I was wondering, what is the contract between fragments and the layout service? So do you have some kind of style guide or component library that you basically require fragments to adhere to?
Perfect question. Yep.
This is basically another talk of its own. We created an internal component library that is based on React.js. There also we evaluated lots of other options. But this component library makes sure that we are not getting that patchwork of differently looking, behaving things. So when you want to be part of the Mosaic architecture, you're not constrained to anything. But when you want to be part of the fashion store and you want to look like a fashion store application, we kind of, by convention, require you to use that component library. And that component library is its own fragment that provides like a JavaScript, React.js, shell that is always there that the fragments can rely on.
And this is the only part where we can no longer guarantee full autonomy, for good reasons, because we had to find a good balance between having a consistent website and not things like the AWS console, where it's clear that every link was done by a different person. This was not tolerable, so we had to find the right balance between always trying to have a consistent look and feel across, but at the same time trying to maximize the autonomy. So yes, we did have to define and fix some things like this base assets and the shaker, the component library, which is unfortunately not open source, but these are actually the two things that are the answer for your question.
Also there, we evaluated a lot of interesting options that would not have forced the teams to use a specific technology like React.js, but at the time they failed because some browsers were not fast enough. I think in that case it was Android Mobile or Safari Mobile. Sure. We periodically reevaluate that approach based on web components, and if that ever becomes fast enough and not a problem with existing technologies, we will go that route so that we also don't force a specific technology on the front-end teams. But right now, for the fashion store, it has to be React.js.
Awesome. Well, thank you, Luis and Moritz. It was really, I was blown away. I know thank you. More folks have questions. Feel free to stick around and ask them. But let's give them another round of applause.
Thank you. Cool.